warmed up about the Fraser River system for me, so hopefully this introduction will just give you a refresher and teach a few more people that just entered the room right now. Anyway, first off, thank you all for attending my talk on silicate versus carbonate weathering, isotopic covariability in the Fraser River, Canada. Before diving in, I would first like to acknowledge all of the collaborators and the agencies without which none of this work would have ever been accomplished. Specifically, my funding is derived from the DAAD, NSF, Northern California Geological Society, and the Geological Society. Since you're all here in a weathering session at a geochemistry conference, I'm going to jump right into it and assume that we're all here inherently interested in quantifying silicate and carbonate fluxes into the global ocean, and that you've at least maybe heard of these four systems before, specifically magnesium, calcium, strontium. And for the strontium, I'm referring to both radiogenic and stable strontium systems. So we have now heard about the Fraser River system. By the way, I'm also going to be presenting my data relative in per mil notation relative to DSM standards 915A and SRM 987, respectively. And the Fraser River system is the one that I work in. So during paleocean chemistry reconstructions, you can have a lot of different signatures, and they can be complicated by different processes, such as sedimentation processes, hypothermal inputs, crust alteration, you name it. It gets complicated. And so a lot of studies have opted to go for this isotopic covariation index. So for example, Goldschmidt et al. In 2014 looked at how different isotope systems covaried, and then was able to glean additional information out of using multiple systems. So what I am doing, I'm using multiple systems in the Fraser watershed. And the reason why the Fraser is, I'm going to go into some more detail because this is really the focus of my work, is that it is incredibly geologically diverse. So we have up here in the inland area over by the headwaters, you have, for example, the tributary the Fitzwilliam. This is draining 764 million year old sedimentary rocky mountains with some carbonates included in there. Highly radiogenic. And in stark comparison to the Chilcotin tributary, for example, which is draining the Coast Range, it is far less radiogenic, you know, only 42 million year old basalts making up the overwhelming majority of that. And then we have the same samples, as you heard about previously in the last talk, coming from the time series. So there is this time series location. If you've ever been to Vancouver, you're very close to it. And it is constantly sampling every approximately 2 weeks. 2009, and you can think of this as an integration of all the different regimes that are coming in from across the watershed, and you have all of this different chemistry coming in at different points during the year, and we have this incredible opportunity to look at seasonality of the mixing here. And to give you a sense of just how variable the chemistry is here at this time series location, I have plotted for you on the x-axis calcium-sodium ratios, and then on the y-axis magnesium-sodium ratios. And these are some relevant dissolved end members, silicate, carbonate, and evaporite. And first I'm going to show for you all of the samples from 2009 to 2012, absolutely everything that was ever sampled in the Fraser River system, and you see that you have this very large range. Right here, these are the samples of the time series, so you can also see about where their range lies. We also sampled from the Fitzwilliam tributary, as well as the Chilcotin tributaries, the two that I discussed earlier. And so you can see that I'm probably going to be using these as end members. And then to give you another sense about the variability that we see here in the time series, I have plotted for you still calcium-sodium ratios on the x-axis, and then the radiogenic strontium composition on the y-axis, and the time series values in the middle. And then I'd like to bring your attention to just the incredible scale that we have here for the radiogenic strontium compositions. I mean, we're ranging from 0.70 to 0.75 with the time series going in between the two. And so I know that you already saw some data for the seasonality of the Fraser River system, but we're going to go through this a little bit more for those who just entered the room and didn't see the last talk. So here I have on the x-axis, we have the date, everything from early 2010 until late 2011. And then on the left y-axis, we have the radiogenic strontium composition. And for those of you who are maybe used to thinking about these things in paleo space, I just wanted it to be really evident that we're actually going toward more sedimentary carbonate inputs with a more radiogenic signature, And then because it's incredibly young silicates going down toward the less rated signature for the Coast Range. And discharge is plotted on the right y-axis. So this here is the radiogenic strontium composition. This work was published back in 2014 by Boss et al. And this is how it compares to the discharge rates. Really nice seasonality. So for those of you that are from cold weather climates, I mean, you probably looked at this and said, oh, I know exactly what's happening. Well, I'm from Hawaii. I think 20 degrees centigrade is a fairly cold day. So I actually didn't understand what was going on until I realized that we have spring freshets. So you have this snowpack that builds up during the winter months. And it is essentially making it so that the tributaries are not really releasing that signature out into the rest of the watershed. And then it starts to warm up, and then you have this release, these meltwater pulses essentially, of this incredibly radiogenic signature coming in from those inland tributaries and causing these spikes in discharge that are correlated with these spikes in radiogenic strontium. So this is a work that occurred with radiogenic strontium, and Voss et al. Created this mixing model that I'm going to go more into detail with later. And this work essentially showed that it could be explained using this more or less a two N-member mixing paradigm. And now what we're going to be going through is my stable isotope data to see how that correlates, how much of it can actually be explained by this two N-member mixing sort of a system versus how much we're going to have to be taking into account other processes. So, jumping right in, stable isotopes. All right, so we have same dates here down on the x-axis, and then we have stable magnesium isotopes here on the y-axis. And you can see that we do have some seasonality going on here, albeit it's not quite as clear as the radiogenic strontium signature. And then we have the calcium isotope values, and yeah, similarly to that potassium isotope talk that we just heard from. Not really any sort of obvious seasonality showing up right here. And then we have the stable strontium story. And while there isn't seasonality that's quite as stark as its radiogenic counterpart, you can see that there is some sort of seasonality. And then this is really just to give you all an overview sense of what it looks like. And now we're going to dive into how it actually compares with the system that we know the best, which is the radiogenic strontium signature. So here we have stable isotope N numbers plotted in gray and then yellow. So radiogenic strontium is on the x-axis and then stable magnesium is on the y-axis. So we have that Chilcotin tributary, the time series samples, and I don't actually have the magnesium isotope values for those Rocky Mountain samples, but those will be forthcoming. Then we have the calcium isotope values, and you can see here that we don't really have much of a differentiation between the two different M numbers. And so this is probably part of the reason why we don't see terribly much variability in the seasonality of that system. And then we have stable strontium, where you do have an offset between the two different M numbers that we're using for this work. Now, if you actually zoom up to only the time series samples, then you see that we have a relatively different story to talk about here. So magnesium isotopes, we do have a significant correlation with radiogenic strontium, and this indicates that it's likely to be explained, at least in most part, due to this two N-member mixing idea, and so that is promising. And then we have this calcium isotope plot, where you can see that we don't really have any sort of two N-member mixing system indicated, at least we don't see it right now. And then stable strontium, where at first glance you think, oh, okay, well, there's really not much there. But then, this is the beauty about working in the modern, and like we actually just heard in the question from the last one, you have so much data because there's so much monitoring and so many people studying the Fraser system that I actually have the opportunity to take a look at the other chemical parameters and the discharge rates and everything like that and see that while this isn't, I mean, this is all still very preliminary, but it rather seems that that we have kind of a different relationship occurring during base flow conditions where the inputs are derived from the Coast Range compared to where we get more of that Rocky Mountain influence. And then at the higher discharge rates, then we have relatively heavy stable strontium values. So that was also an interesting finding. And now, plotting all these graphs is great and all, but we really need a predictive model that's actually going to be able to tell us why these isotope systems are changing in the way that they are in this system. And so what I'm doing is I am utilizing the same model as was developed by Voss et al., but making some changes to it. And so her model was essentially an additive one of taking all of these different tributaries that are located here on the map, adding them in with a timeline, and then predicting what the radiogenic strontium composition would be down at the time series. So this is what this model looked like, and it is quite a lovely fit. And of course, everything can always be improved, but this is really what the model was idealized for. So you have everything from 2009 to 2011. It has a fabulous fit. And then I thought, okay, well, this essentially here is like a 2N member mixing thinking between these incredibly radiogenic Rocky Mountains and the much less radiogenic Coast Range. So magnesium isotopes, those were correlating quite well with the radiogenic strontium composition. So I thought I would go ahead and do a little thought experiment where I created hypothetical magnesium isotopic compositions for each one of these different tributaries that were added into the model, just to see what magnesium isotopic variability we see in the time series could actually be explained through just a 2N member mixing. So here we have still discharge again, but now on the left y-axis we have dissolved magnesium isotopic compositions. And this is what the time series data actually looks like. So this is what the magnesium isotopic composition is on any one of those given days. And this is what just this hypothetical 2N member mixing model would look like. So you can see that it doesn't fit near as well as a radiogenic strontium, but this is one of those opportunities where it's exciting to see when your model doesn't fit, because it means you get to take other things into account and make the model better. So with that, takeaway points is that magnesium isotopes in the Fraser River system may be explainable with this 2N member mixing, and calcium and stable strontium variability cannot be explained by mixing alone at this time. Future work will also include lithium isotopes, and it will include further model preparation. And I have no idea how many more minutes I have left for questions, but if you did have any and you're interested in this isotope system or any of these isotope systems, I guess my question for you all would be, how might I synthesize this data in a way that's actually useful for you? Because at the end of the day, that's really what I'd like to do, is be useful. So that's a lot to ask for in a minute. Feel free to email me.